The Holy Spirit came down upon the apostles 10 days after the ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is as Jesus had promised his disciples. Let us see a clip and see what happened.
After Jesus went back to heaven, his friends and helpers were praying together in a big room. Suddenly, something amazing happened. At first, it sounded as if a huge wind were blowing. Next, flames of fire flickered over every person's head. Then God's Spirit came, and everyone began to speak in different languages. This was the gift from God that Jesus had promised his followers. The day that God's Spirit came to Jesus' followers, there were people from many countries in Jerusalem. These people spoke different languages. When they heard Jesus' friends praying, they went to see what the noise was all about. They found Jesus' friends telling about the great things God had done, but they were all surprised to hear it in their own language. They asked, "What does this mean?" After that day, when the Holy Spirit first came, Jesus' followers began to do many miracles. Telling people about God's love and how Jesus had come to save them. One afternoon, Peter and John went to the temple. A man who couldn't walk sat there begging for money. Peter looked at him and said,
"I don't have any money, but I do have something else I can give you. By the power of Jesus Christ from Nazareth, stand up and walk."
Up jumped the man. His feet and ankles were now strong. He was healed.
Thank you. Extraordinary things happened when the power of the Holy Spirit fell on the disciples. You remember in Acts 1:8, Jesus told his disciples, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth." And the day on which he came down upon the apostles is called Whit Sunday or Pentecost. I will dwell on this, but let me pray, O God, that your Spirit will fall on us afresh. We will invite your Holy Spirit on this of our lives as Christians, as leaders, and as evangelists and missionaries. We take the Holy Spirit with us to energize us, to help us move into the darkened world and to preach the good news of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Many people feel powerless in many ways. And when you have someone to help you attain something, that you could not attain, you feel the power. There are many powers around the world that we go for. One of the most powerful thing or two that a human being can have is money. Those people who have money, they feel they have power. Depending on your level. And those who do not have money, they feel so vulnerable because they will desire things and they will not do it. That is kind of power. There are some people that are created with some kind of strength. And even if they walk in a place where there are gangsters, they don't fear. There was a time I was very well built, and I moved around. I was telling my wife, if two thieves come and confront me, I will not fight. I will not fear so much. But if you are weak, you will fear. And actually, one time they attempted to. Four boys came and, you know, they tried to rob me, and they lifted me. It was not easy. So instead, they grabbed my coat this way, the other one this way, and they tied my coat and ran away with my money. But it is not that if I was less strong at that time, that is body strength. Sometimes when we visit Kenya, we want to be near our friend who has a gun. Because even in some places that you go in the bushes, you know, to see the wild or something like that, we feel we are secure because we have someone here with a gun. Because there are small robbers who can just decide to descend on you and, you know, just tease you with a knife. But this gentleman, you know, gives us some courage because he has the power of the little thing. And I'm very sure that is why in this country I've seen the sense why most people, because you lived away from one another, you want to get another extra power because there is no neighbor near you. You have that power within the house. And you know, you don't fear, although you are maybe many, many miles away from your neighbor. And a friend of mine that is dad was partially seeing. And he told me, you know, dad lives alone. But dad knows where his gun is. If you touch the door, he is with his gun. And he knows where the door is. He was partially blind, but he had the power of his mind and the gun. Well, those are not some of the powers that we need, because other people can corner you even with that power. The church does not need that kind of power. Jesus knew. His disciples did not need to fight, because the Jews had fought many battles, killing a lot of other people, but still they were overcome from time to time and they were taken into captivity. And you remember they wanted him to give them the power when they asked him, Lord, when are you going to restore back the kingdom of the Jews or the Judaizers? He told them, I'm not interested with that kind of kingdom. I am interested with the kingdom of God. And so he told them, this is what I will ask my Father to do, to equip you to fight for the heavenly kingdom. Not these kingdoms here, because heaven and earth shall pass away. And so we are told that when the day of Pentecost came, they were together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. You saw the cartoon that we saw, but I'm sorry, where did the rats came from? I don't know whether they were in fellowship, I don't know. But we are told these guys were together. They were together and they stayed, they obeyed to stay together. You know, as I was preparing this sermon, the Lord reminded me this is the reason why Satan has devised a method that the unbelievers, Christians, will not sit down together. Because you see, the Bible tells us where two or three are gathered, whatever they bind in this world, it is bound in heaven. Whatever they release, it is released in heaven. Isn't it that power? Amen? So when we are seated here, Satan is not happy because he was thinking this wouldn't be, the churches wouldn't be closed indefinitely. There is no opening in the near future. And you know, continue pumping fear. But in glory be to God, on this Pentecost day, we are here to tell the enemy, you are today drowned into the deepest pit with all your plans, with all your COVID-19, and we are back again to cast you out in the name of Jesus. Amen? Amen. We have power. We have power to tell Satan and its ingratitude to pack and go to the lake of sulfur and fire. And it indeed happened because they stayed together and they did the necessary. We are told that Jesus' mother was with them. Jesus' brothers were together with these guys. And the sign that came was that there was a real blowing, heavy, spindle wind. And they thought it was the cancer's wind. It was not. Yeah? It did not go. And if it is a time like now when the wind has refused to clear from Jetimo, what should we start thinking doing? Vanishing down to our hiding place. They stayed. And all of a sudden, fire was upon each and everyone. And all together, because there were different people of different nationalities there, they started talking. Murungu no mwela, ngai no mwela, Mungu ni mwema, our God is good. Glory be, yani everyone, when they talked, they asked each other, what is this happening? But they remembered they were promised the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? This is exactly what we need to remember. This is what we need to remember, that the church will never function without the presence of the Holy Spirit. And you know it is pathetic. And I'm sorry to say that we have sometimes refused to recognize the power of the Holy Spirit. You remember when the Azusa Fellowship started in California, many shot out of there, spread throughout America, and they went to Canada. And a new movement of the Holy Spirit Church started, the Pentecostal churches. And instead of embracing them, because they were, when you enter into the hall, they are all speaking in tongues and very fiery with confidence, and then people say, no, this is not the type of church we are. Our church is of men and women who come and we sing when we are stiffly standing. We don't make noise when the other one is praying. Yeah? And the enemy started putting some divisions, and then these people were nicknamed. And as they were nicknamed, the other churches were getting less concerned with the power of the Holy Spirit. And I want to tell you, We need to go back and invite the presence of the Holy Spirit. Because it is then that when we have that power, Jesus told them, when that power comes, you will start being my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, at the end of the world. The Church of Jesus Christ needs to know that it is a mission church. In your Jerusalem, you and your spouse and your children and your grandchildren, how are you witnessing to your Jerusalem? You know, in some homes, it's time for prayer. Daddy, you can pray with mom. Let us go play our game. The Lord is telling us that we need to start from our Jerusalem because this is a beautiful message of giving hope. It is a message that gives power more than anything in this world. It is a message of going to heaven and live in eternity. It is not something that we need to joke around. No. No. It is something that we need to tell each other with passion. We need to tell the other person about heaven, which is beautiful than where we are. Our Jerusalem, our Judea, people that are our neighbors, those who know us, why do you tell them about Jesus Christ? About your Samaria, those who are partners with you, those who that are working with you in offices or wherever you work. Do you have a witness about heaven where we shall live millions and millions of years, forever and ever? End of the world is the mission field that is behold here, behold Kansas. End of the world is out there. The Lord is telling us the church need to go back to its drawing board and start inviting the presence of the Holy Spirit. We are told that what energized the Mary, Mother of Jesus, and the disciples is prayer. The power of prayer. We need to revisit this idea. We need to be prayerful men and women. We need to have groups of men and women within this church and within the entire church of Jesus Christ that we, at least once or twice a year, we are connected with that group of men and women that we are praying together. Prayer is the power that moves mountains. As a family, you need to have a moment of prayer. If you have reunion once a year or so, you need to have a day of prayer for your family, either through Zoom or they come in physical. And you pray together. It is better than other reunions. You pray and you ask each other as you ask each other. What degree did you graduate with? I know some families, when they come together, they start asking one another, what degree did you graduate with, my cousin in California? We want to ask them what level of faith they have. Brethren, heaven is better than the degrees we get here. Let us be vigilant. Talk about it. The apostles and other people were filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, and the people spoke in tongues. They spoke in tongues, and actually we are told that immediately they were filled with the power, great things started happening. And when they started speaking with the tongues, this is what came about. Peter told them, this was spoken by prophet Joel. This was spoken by prophet Joel, said they will be filled, people will be filled with the Spirit. And what will happen is that your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. We need young people to prophesy. We need young people in this church. We need to include our young people in the agenda of preaching and evangelism. Because they are the ones with, you know, sound mind. Instead of having illusions, they will prophesy the proper prophecies. Where are our young people? We need young men, we need young women here. At least we have two here, we have three, we have four. We need them in numbers so that they will prophesy with the Methodist Church in the United Methodist Church and the whole Wesleyan movement believe in prophecies. We need to start prophesying. Brother, you need to start prophesying. It's a gift that we need to ask for. We need to speak in tongues. Hallelujah. Tongues are not for the Pentecostals alone. We need to start doing those things, and then we are told that your own men will dream dreams. Your own men will dream dreams. And they dream clear dreams on how to extend the church. Joe, do you dream? Yes. Very good. We need men, old men and women who are dreamers. They dream about this and we say, yes, that is the real dream. We want to go by your dream. But you know, some people will dream and then say, I think I have some temperatures. What is happening? What did I dream last night? We need young men to see visions. We need to see visions. And then when these things happen, what will happen? We shall be a church that is full of power. We shall perform all miracles. We shall heal. Amen. We shall have wisdom. Hallelujah. We will have men and women with knowledge, and we shall be able to interpret the things of God. It is the church. The movement will take off. We will not be retrogressive. We will not talk of things of the past. We will not dwell in businesses of talking about who is greater or who is less. We will be filled with one message, focusing on Jesus. Today is the day of Pentecost. God bless you. Let you go and pray for something. I pray that God will give you some power. It is when we will be able to tell people, no, you are wrong here. You are right here. We will hold each other as we march to heaven. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Please stand and we'll do our closing song.
Spirit song. May the Holy Spirit fill you and take you with you on your way up.
God, fill your eyes.
Thank you. We know the church that will make a difference internally and externally is the church that recognizes the presence of the Holy Spirit. Christians that will make a difference in this world as we fight and overcome the power of the enemy are the ones that you will be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Families that will overcome any kind of evil and darkness, the city and the nation that will fight and stand for Jesus Christ is the nation, the city that invites the presence of the Holy Spirit. I now pray in the name of God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Receive that power. Walk with that power. Deliver through that power for eternity's sake. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Peace of God be with you.